history of this case and the impact of Mr. Bigham, his case, and how it weaves into the story is Julia Silverman, an editor with Portland Monthly. Good morning.
Uh-oh.
Can you hear us, Julia? Did we lose you there?
Oh no.
I think she's frozen. So we'll see if we can get her back here in just a second. But I think we might need to give it just a minute and go to
our forecast?
I hear clicking.
Okay.
Our producer's gonna troubleshoot in the booth. You take it from there, Christian. You handle it and we'll check in on that forecast.
Okay. Well, we're gonna go to the weather right now, because you know that's always reliable, Kelly.
Yeah, I'm here ready to give you the forecast.
We appreciate you.
It's gonna be a nice one today, you guys. So we're expecting to hit the 80s moving into our afternoon, and as we start, we are now in the mid to upper 50s. We're getting plenty of sunshine around the region, and it's just a beautiful start. Take a look out towards Mount Hood. Lovely blue skies, not much snow left from all of our warm temperatures, and we have seen some snowy periods this June. We have seen a number of systems bringing in some cooler air and snow to the mountains, but quick to melt off once again. As we start, though, we are looking at a beautiful morning here. Partly cloudy moving forward by lunchtime in the low 70s. And our highs today close to the 80s around the valley. So high pressure is starting to rebuild, and that is giving way to sunshine and dry conditions at this point in the week here. And through Friday, we're still looking dry, but we are tracking this system that will bring our next round of weather back to the Pacific Northwest. A lot of that impact will be up north in Washington, but we could get clipped by a cold front here that may bring a little bit of rain through Saturday. So we'll be tracking that moving forward. Saturday, of course, is our first day of summer, and we could pair that with a little bit of rain. So not great timing on that, but that rain should move out quickly. And by the start of next week, we're looking at drier conditions. But there's the rain as we head towards our late morning, early afternoon. We'll see a chance for some light rainfall here in Portland. And again, much of the rain will stay north of Portland and mainly in Washington, but out towards the coast, we could also see some showers and up and over the coast range as well. By Sunday, maybe a drizzle for the morning, but by the afternoon, we should clear out and see partly sunny skies. So things do shape up by Father's Day, especially around the afternoon. But on Saturday, we'll be watching for scattered showers. Today, of course, and Friday, dry. And in the 80s, come Monday and Tuesday of next week, we're back to some calm and summer-like weather here as we move into the start of next week. So 80 degrees in Portland today, upper 60s out towards the coast. Here's your 7-day forecast. Enjoy this weather now. A brief round of showers come the weekend, but by Monday and beyond, we're back in the 80s with a lot of sunshine. Back to you guys.
Kelly, hey, technology is fun. We've got Portland Monthly editor Julia Silverman back with us. Good morning, Julia.
Good morning, ladies. I'm sure that's not the first time that's happened to you.
No, we're used to it. I think our viewers would tell you it probably happens almost daily. But I'm glad you're no longer frozen. Hey, before we dig into Brett Bigham's story, I want to talk to you real quick this morning. Another Supreme Court case with a really big ruling here on DACA.
Man, the news just does not stop. It's a great time to be a journalist. Yes, this morning, the Supreme Court, in a blow to the Trump administration, in a 5-4 decision, ruled that the Trump administration cannot dissolve the DACA program, which is the program that has allowed kids whose parents brought them to the United States to remain in the country and work towards a path to citizenship. It's a big win for immigrant rights groups, and it is, I think, in many ways unexpected, and it sort of continues this trend from earlier this week. I think many people, including Oregon teacher Brett Bigham, thought that the LGBTQ ruling was going to go in another direction.
Yeah, and so tell us about the Brett Bigham story. For people who aren't familiar, I wasn't all that familiar until I started reading his Twitter this week and that long thread he wrote about what happened to him. It's pretty crazy.
I think it was, the word I used in my story about it was cathartic, and that's what it felt like to me reading that Twitter thread, that here was somebody who had been holding this inside for 6 years now and decided now is the moment. I think as many people are right now, right? Now is the moment to for a lot of things. So Brett Bigham was a teacher with the Multnomah Education Service District, and he worked with 18 to 21 year olds teaching life skills. And he was nominated as the Oregon Teacher of the Year and won, which, as you guys know, is a big honor. And almost though immediately after he was awarded that, you know, honor, his relationship with his employers began to go sour. And if you read through his Twitter thread, it includes some really egregious allegations of what he says, of ways he says the district treated him, including threatening to shoot him in the head if he continued to talk out about being gay and how his sexuality had, you know, what it meant to him. And it's really quite something. He isn't the plaintiff in the landmark LGBTQ case that the Supreme Court decided upon this week, but he was a part of the case in that the Southern Poverty Law Center included his story and what had happened to him, because eventually he wound up losing his job. He was fired at Multnomah ESD. They included his story in what's called an amicus brief, a friend of the court brief that they filed. So it would have been reviewed by the justices when they made their decision. And for when I talked to Brett yesterday, he said he had been steeling himself for the decision to go a different way. And when it came out, he said, overcome. And that's when he sat down and fired off this sort of missive on Twitter that concluded with asking for an apology from MESD, even though he said he, you know, he didn't expect such a thing to ever happen. Well, a few hours later, MESD did in fact apologize, and I'll read a little bit of it to you, and anybody can read it. It's on their website, multnomahesd.org. They wrote, "We apologize to Mr. Brett Bigham. No one should have to endure the discriminatory actions that Mr. Bigham describes experiencing at MESD. They were wrong when they occurred, just as they would be wrong today."
Wow.
Wow.
Great to hear an apology for him after he shared what has obviously been a very, you know, personal and traumatic experience, I would imagine. When this ruling came down, I know there was some talk about the fact that several states had protections. There were legal protections at the state and local level in certain communities, but I don't know if he touched on this at all. What's the significance of having this put into law at the federal level, having the Supreme Court weigh in on this, and now it is the law of the land?
When I talked to him, he talked a great deal about the next generation, as you might imagine a teacher would do. He's currently a kindergarten through fifth grade teacher at Pioneer Special School here in Portland, and he works particularly with kids who are differently abled. And he talked about wanting that next generation to know that they can be who they want to be without fear of losing their livelihood as a result.
Wow, yeah, it's so powerful. Well, thank you for breaking that down for us and for people who maybe weren't familiar with his case specifically and how it played a role in this. And of course, if people want to learn more about the Supreme Court ruling and how this Oregon man was involved, they can read all about it in this month's issue of Portland Monthly, online and print.
All right, don't go anywhere.